Today's conversation, I'm privileged to have two beautiful ladies and a gentleman who's going to help us discuss into detail the role of aviation in tourism. In fact, the role of aviation building back tourism well. So without further much ado, I'll start with Kwakye Donkor. Mr. Kwakye is the CEO of African Tourism Partners, also as the convener of African Tourism Leadership Forum. He's held a number of positions, including RITOSA. And if you don't know, RITOSA is a South African regional tourism body, defunct. I don't know whether it's working now. And then he also works with a number of tourism boards and countries, and also in consultancy. Mr. Kwakye, let me come to you that if we know that aviation and tourism, like we said, they are bedfellows. Now, yes, we know they are bedfellows, but again, we cannot see how both sectors, so both subsectors, are working in hand to produce what we call seamless travel for the end user, but ultimately help to have, air access, and then people will have the choice of, traveling in Africa with ease. So what would you recommend now that, we know we are coming from COVID, but we want to also be prepared for the challenges ahead. And so if you want to build back better, how do you see the role between the two, the tourism boards or tourism destination managers, or if you like the ministry, are the policymakers, and then aviation players' role in building back tourism as we go along? A bit of a loaded question, but let's go.
No, thank you, Pedro. And great to see you all, and great to see some fantastic participants on this in this session. It's a very important point that you've raised, and I think it's very simple. One critical thing that we haven't done well across the industry, not only in Africa but globally, is collaboration between aviation and tourism. They don't speak to each other. And I think this is a big opportunity, particularly in Africa, to basically start that process. If you look at a lot of countries, the tourism minister and the tourism operation don't talk to each other. And that is why we have issues like the huge airport taxes, making flights extremely expensive, making it impossible for low-cost flight to be basically moving across the continent. So one critical thing that is needed to be able to resolve that, I have been proposing and advocating for this, to have a working group between tourism and aviation to make sure that the two talk. Now, when that happens, then solid case can be or could be presented to government, parliamentarians, policymakers to look into the cost of travel, because we are robbing Peter to pay Paul. We charge so much, people cannot travel. At the same time, we want tourism arrivals. How do we achieve that? It's totally impossible. So this is the first thing that needs to happen. There are countries, I've just checked, one of the African countries where the government is basically subsidizing flights, airlines, to allow people to be able to come in. Because when you have more people coming in and staying longer, they are going to spend the money, and the money is still going to be left in the country. And you get a lot more from that. So in a nutshell, we need a stronger collaboration between aviation and tourism. The partnership we are talking about, not only across the countries, but partnership between tourism and aviation in across the continent, rather in domestic, for domestic tourism growth as well.
Okay, Mr. Kwakye, I think we will come to nitty-gritty of, because I still believe that sometimes there's an issue of bureaucracy, and you have all these standing committees and people believe that they are living on an island in terms of their aviation and tourism, but I think we're going to come to that. Dr. Carmen Nibigira is a tourism policy analyst, and she's got a depth of experience working with agencies, with multilaterals, and she's got experience about how we are able as tourism people. So she comes with a background of tourism expertise. Now, as an analyst and with all this rich experience from the East African Tourism Platform, Okay. What kind of advice, okay, are you looking at giving to these government institutions or sub-regional groups in terms of building back better?
Well, thank you so much, Kojo. I would like maybe to use a citation I borrow always from Eric Kaku, one of the author of Fly Africa. He said that for Africa to rise, it has to fly. That's quite a profound statement, which in my view, for Africa to rise, it has to fly. Our continent is quite huge in size, and our infrastructure is still very lacking. And if I talk about the East African community, we really depend on each other. We have six member states. Among those, we only have Kenya and Tanzania with access to the ocean. Other countries are landlocked. And if you really look at how we connect from tourism and travel in the East African community, we only have two major players as national carriers. This is Kenya Airways from Kenya and Rwandair connecting the rest of East Africa. So if we want to talk about the role of aviation in rebuilding tourism in Africa, we still have a long way to go. From a policy standpoint, I know some of our East African countries, in the case of Rwanda and Burundi, we are quite small. Within 5 hours, you are on one side of the border. And the roads have been kind of like, I would say, to the credit of our leaders, improved, because we depend on each other very, very much. But I doubt that this will be the same case if you want really to drive the same agenda, connecting Rwanda to Botswana, for instance. We look at geographically not possible. So if we really want to connect in terms of trade, business, tourism, whether it's leisure, health, education, Africa to really rise, it needs to fly.
No, that's true. And if you look at the global numbers, globally, 45.5% constitute the mode of transport for tourists at all destinations. In fact, Africa could be more because of our challenges in some of our infrastructure, meaning that air access is really very key in terms of developing tourism. Amanda, yes. She's the key account manager, airlines and government agencies for the Cape Town International Airport. Okay, so you've been in a lot of meetings, pitching, speaking to airlines, coming through and all of that. If you look at from the airport point of view, and I mean, you can cite the example of Westgro. We know that you have a bit of a good relationship with them. But, across the continent, we don't have that particular model where you see tourism boards or ministries engage together to be able to attract an airline. Because, look, we are in a situation that sometimes you don't necessarily have a flat career, but you can have a fee to them, right? Walk us through those processes, speaking to the airlines and how you believe that tourism players and then the aviation guys can come together to ensure that we have tourism well developed on the continent.
Thank you, Kojo. I think the biggest thing that has happened, I think, and what Cape Town has really been able to coin was really just that kind of relationship of looking at the industry as a whole. So looking at it and saying, yes, we are the destination of choice for every airline or most destinations, I mean, throughout the world. But what you're looking at is that you need to define what it is that you are as a port of entry. So as Cape Town, we're a leisure destination. We know that we are, we are very grand at that. We also know that in terms of cargo and some of the business elements, we are one of those. But it's a bit of a sort of a conundrum if you only have one. For example, if you've got the airport going to an airline and saying, come to us and fly from us because we are the best possible people to be able to, to transport your travelers. Meanwhile, the city itself is not geared up for that kind of travel. So it's almost like a conjunction between these two to say, we want the travel, we want the numbers, and these are the passengers that are coming through, and this is how much those passengers are bringing with them. And not only that, you're looking at the perspective of business, you're also saying if that airline comes and it is in that particular region, for example, we are now connected to 23 airports in the world, and we're looking at it and we're saying, so where else are we not connected to? So it's all about connectivity. Let's connect those passengers to come through to our country because they are part of the tourism sector. This is how much they are spending. This is how much they are staying. And we use all the channels. So Cape Town Tourism, Westgrow, the airport uses, they share the data in order for them to be able to make an informed decision as to what is the actual value of tourism for Cape Town. So it's almost like a whole pie and not just aviation brings this and what do those people come through. So the hotels and everybody else has got an understanding that if we've got 8.9 million customers, for example, like we did in 2018, what does that mean for the industry? Is it all business? What does it mean for cargo? It mean for the different industries that we as Cape Town have in order to sell this sort of business kind of thing for any airline that wants to come. So at the moment, we know that it takes us about 3 to 4 years just to get one airline coming through. If we look at it as Cape Town ourselves, we are not connected to two different, there's only two places in the world we are not really connected to. So we've got United Airlines now that is, you know, it's coming from the America, the United States. We are looking for a airline that's going to come directly from Brazil. You know, that's going to really help us. And also maybe from the Australia, New Zealand kind of region, because we can see that there is connectivity that's happening on the current airlines for those passengers to come into our city. So there's business to be done there.
Now, if we just on the same point, if we look at having route development, do you bring the tourism people on board? Because like I said, you know, in your peculiar situation of Westgrow, they have a certain structure that allows you guys to have meetings. But if you're looking at, if airlines want to fly to Cape Town, okay, do you have the conversation with, say, SA Tourism or, you know, other partners that you believe that they can bring something to the table?
Yes, we've been fortunate enough in that it's actually started with the government. So the government actually deployed the Westgrow channel. So they created Westgrow, and Westgrow created a specific decision that talks about air access. But in terms of that, they look at a range of things in terms of Cape Town. But it started with the government. So it's almost like a joint venture between the Western Cape Tourism, South African Tourism, the airport company, the actual government itself, that's in the Western Cape, as well as all the other channel partners. So it becomes a situation where the processes are different and the economics are already there because everybody's got a vested interest in developing this route because it's going to bring certain things to different industries. So then you get those channeled partners on board because then it becomes an easier conversation to have. And you don't really have to fight much or even talk to them much because they already know that thing that they want.
Okay, Kwakye, let me come back to that. If you have a situation where, you know, sometimes and you know, Cape Town may be a bit peculiar, but in most parts of the continent where you realize that airport people or the people working in the airport or the aviation or the ground handling or the Ministry of Aviation or Transport, sometimes, look, the posture is, we're a bit technical agency. We deal with these people coming through, okay? And then the tourism people are saying, all right, listen, we have the numbers. We know which are the source market. How do we get them to understand that, look, you have to be together to be able to attract, in fact, sometimes make a pitch to airlines to come to your destination because we have considerably inadequate infrastructure. That would mean that air access will be a core thing in promoting travel in Africa. Mm-hmm. How do we get them to understand those nitty-gritties of it?
Thank you once again. It's about two things. It's about education and advocacy. Yeah. Now, with both of them, you need to have the numbers. I mean, a lot of tourism authorities, unfortunately, don't have the numbers available, and if they do, they are not even accurate. So for you to win the case and educate the airport, the aviation guys have their numbers, right? But the airports may not have. You have to make sure that the statistics and the data analytics are solid, yeah, to the extent that you can use that one to prove to them why tourism is an economic priority sector that contributes a certain percentage of the GDP to the country. Without tourism, they will not be working at the airport. That is first one. The second point is people must understand what tourism entails. What are the key components of tourism? Tourism goes beyond just ordinary travel. They are the same people who travel to our countries are the people who bring the investment. So if you have the statistics and the figures to show that through tourism, there has been so much investment into the country, and particularly if you look at the mine sector, how much that is bringing into the knowledge economy of a country, you'll be able to win the case. And let me educate our colleagues. Not that they don't know, but they need to understand the detail. They need to understand what makes tourism. They need to understand what contribution the tourism is making to the country across the entire value chain.
No, that's
and unfortunately, of engagement does not take place. And that is why I started by saying we need to start collaborating. And if I talk of a working group, I don't mean getting 20 people together, having meetings and meetings and meetings and nothing happens. I'm talking of having the figures, agreeing when measured, what we want to achieve, and as a country, setting the target. The third point, which I did not mention, is leadership. Most of the time, it depends on the leadership of the country. Does the leader of the country consider tourism as a priority sector? If they do, then it also becomes their responsibility to bring the two corners of their country together, to sit around the table. A couple of countries are doing it in Africa, and it's very exciting. Rwanda, for instance, the Rwanda tourism talks to Rwanda aviation. They talk to the Rwanda air. Senegal, doing the same. Cape Town does the same. South Africa, all their challenges, they do the same. So there are good practices out there that we could possibly learn from. And that will be my response particular issue. Thank you.
Carmen, I want to continue on the point of leadership. Now, with your experience working both for regional groups and also working very closely with the tourism private sector, I see our friend Mohamed Hersey from Kenya is here. How do we then are able to bring these people on board and say that, okay, let them understand the rudiments of it? Because I'm just going back to the same question that if you have the tourism stakeholders, okay, and the tourism board, and you have the aviation and all of that, remember that there's a common denominator. But over and above, you find out that the tourism stakeholders, the private sector, they get information being relayed to them, okay? And sometimes there's always the complexities, or we create that a bit of complex to say that it's being handled by technical men. We know that. But remember that when someone is receiving a particular guest from some country, he understands where the source market is coming from. So how do you then advise them to say that, okay, if you're looking at your policy, you may have to be able to ensure that you have a group, you know, or you have a chemistry between, you know, the policymakers, the DMZ, and the stakeholders. A bit loaded question, for you.
Thank you, Kojo. I'm glad you're asking this question, because I think with COVID-19 pandemic, nobody is going to deny that we need each other. There's not a single sector in the whole value chain which is going to say we are okay alone. We can be left alone. So from a policy standpoint, I will say that all the policymakers now, with COVID-19, we know that a hotel will not get full occupancy if you don't have an airline, an effective airline, which move passengers and clients and your future clients from A to B, B to C. I'm only going to focus on the East African community, for instance. If you come from a country which doesn't have your own national carrier, and you depend on Jomo Kenyatta and then Kenya Airways to get you in and out, definitely as a policymaker from a regional perspective, do we have a luxury not to talk? do we have a luxury of not really doing cooperation within and across all other sectors? I think that's something which is going to be a very interesting debate around the table. And second, I think, Kojo, I always say that from a regional perspective, if we want to bring this conversation beyond and above, we need to understand that the tourism is not just as a standalone business. Right. Any other sector depends on it. We depend on aviation, an effective aviation sector. We need on all the hospitality partners, from food, catering, skills, capacity, human being. We need each other. And then what is quite interesting, if you look at what we have learned in the last 5 months, I would have never thought in my life that a minister of public health, minister of health, will be sitting with the minister of tourism discussing on matters related to tourism. So that shows that one thing, that our industry is highly correlated to issues of policy on security, on health, on trade, on infrastructure. So the Minister of Finance cannot turn their deaf, you know, ears that a tourism is just a standalone. We need to put it together, because if your aviation sector is not robust, resilient, therefore you should not expect anything else in between. Last but equally important, I feel like now we have a really strong case to encourage everybody who's involved in our sector to use the data we have. We had seen that when things are kind of like shut down, what are the consequences? And the consequences are so dire that we cannot afford to go back to that same conversation. So when we lobby and we do a lot of advocacy, and I'm glad on this platform we have Laiko for Mohamed Helsi, and then I cannot tell you how I'm so glad that I worked with him. I know he has always pushed for direct flight from London to Mombasa. You know, when there was a flight from Kigali to Mombasa, tourists from Rwanda would flock into a destination like Diani and Watamu, because that's a destination which offers something Rwanda doesn't have. So if we really want to talk about how holistically we need to work together from a policy standpoint, we need to make the same case as the Minister of Public Health sitting with the Minister of Tourism discussing matters related to tourism. Other sectors have to come in. We need to really connect, and the cooperation has to be within and across other sectors.
No, thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. I think I'll, Amanda, again, on the point that Carmen ended, look, we're building back better. That's the mantra now, and that's the body and soul to ensure that tourism build back better. But we shouldn't also lose sight of the fact that some of these air assets and airlines may not survive. I think some are going down the drain already.
True.
Now, if we look at how are we going to get better in terms of air assets and some going down already, how do we then bring the conversation of, say, for example, having faith freedom rights and necessarily flag carrier not being the ish thing before? Because you don't, and how the world is going now, you don't need a flag carrier to be able to promote a destination. How do we look at the two?
Look, it's a very interesting one, especially now that we find ourselves in this particular pandemic, and absolutely also where we are with our national carrier, and I think that's not even a something that we can hide. Where we finding ourselves and saying we might not have a national carrier. What does that mean? Does that mean that the industry then needs to stand still, and we now need to say, well, we're now going to, you know, as government, because remember, government are the policymakers and allows which airline can have different routes. And we sometimes try as countries to protect the national carrier by giving them more rights. Or when we look at, you know, the biggest airlines, for example, which we are trying to attract, maybe the carrot be in front of it that would put it is to say, look, we'll give you this because you are the biggest carrier. But where we are now is to, I think where government, and I think Kwakye has mentioned it, and I think Carmen has also alluded to it, is how does, because we've got three different ones. We've got the Minister of Transport who looks after aviation. We've got the Minister of Tourism who looks only after tourism. And then you've got the Minister of Health. Now, these three ministries now need to start finding a way to talk to each other. But what we are finding now is that there is a conflicting part of it. The, add additionally to that in the fact that our national carrier is run by a state-owned enterprise. It's a state-owned. So based on that, there are different things. So how do you then attract new airlines? Because there are certain airlines that can at least You know what I'm starting to see? I'm starting to see airlines starting to say, look, there's capacity on this route. I have the availability to be able to make it. I can bring the passengers to your economy. And whether or not I am favorite or favorable, or I'm in competition, direct competition with another airline that you've taken, you have to consider whether this is something that you want as a country in order to build the tourism. And remembering that tourism is about interconnectedness. So if I want to connect to Rwanda and I want to connect to South Africa, it doesn't matter who takes me there. As long as I get there and the experience that I have is something that I can be able to say, I love what I have gotten as a passenger and I will do it again.
Okay, Kwakye. So the same point now is becoming clear that we don't necessarily need flag carriers of every country, all right? And we need strong airlines in the continent, yes. 2-3 strong ones that can be able to connect us together, all right? Mm. Now, if you look at the fact that the airline itself, in apart from bringing us or connecting people together, it creates other ancillary jobs and ancillary, yes. In the last figures by ICAO, we're talking about $6.7 billion in terms of the ancillary businesses. But then again, we come back to the base of the problem, which has always been data. If you don't have your data, how then do you go to begin, engaging with partners to see that whether this route is worthy for us to? Because we see a lot of our African airlines launching routes that, in fact, sometimes you ask a lot of questions why they decided to launch that route apart from pride. Do you share that view?
I do. I share it a lot because once before you even approach an airline to say this is the route, for example, I'm just going to make a silly example about United Airlines. United Airlines looked at us and said, well, not now. And it took a while before they decided to say this is the route that we will take into Cape Town. But while we were able to show them over the period, every single time the team went to routes, was here are the tourism numbers that are growing in Cape Town as a city. Here are the hotels and the vicinity of the biggest destination sort of components that we make up as Cape Town. So these are the things that are business-wise. So some of the growing markets in Cape Town, you know, that will also help. So it's not just about you earning an income based on passenger volumes, also other ancillary incomes that you as an airport or as an airline, has got access to. Here are the ways in which you've got access, not only from a perspective of flying into Cape Town, but also flying out of Cape Town. What is it that you're going to get into your own? So it's almost like what we see in terms of your city and what you see in terms of our city. So what happened is then when we joined these two cities, which is Newark, not New York, it was easy for United Airlines to say it's not a route that everybody's going to. So it's a route that it's available because not everybody's flying from there. It's the New York part we can just do domestically. We can still have the customers that are coming to us and are able to come to Cape Town. Now it was a situation of Cape Town then started advertising New York and Newark as a destination of choice to say here you are as a place from Cape Town. You now can go here and this is what you can get. So it was a sharing of tourism numbers, sharing of numbers of passengers and what those numbers mean to the city and how that comes together in order for the city to gain in as a whole in terms of that, the jobs that are created, some of the businesses that are from those cities as well.
Okay. Kwakye, I'm just coming back to you on data and then how do we, in terms of the partners, aviation and tourism, and if you advise the ministry or if you advise the countries, do you pinpoint to them or do you tell them that they need to be able to bring these key actors together for them to realize what you put on paper for them?
You raise a very important point. I think I'll go back to my initial comment by saying that we need the data. Now, the unfortunate side about tourism, a lot of the tourism ministries and tourism authorities and bodies is that they would like to do the data collection and analysis internally without data scientists. You know, you if you look at COVID, let's use COVID as a case. All the government have got all the best aspects on board to make sure that the data that they provide is accurate, is correct. The right people, they have authorities doing the work that needs to be done. Why can't we do the same in tourism? If you want to build a destination, you bring the people who can actually crack the numbers. If you look at the countries that are doing well, that have got the tourism statistics is not gathered by the tourism ministry. They got the national statistics department or ministry that is totally working in collaboration with the ministry or with the tourism authority to get this data. If you want to do aviation business, bring the best guys on mind. There are thousands and thousands of experts around who could contribute. And all the countries that are doing well, that is what they do. Not just having pieces of paper or getting consultants coming on and writing fat documents and putting those fat documents on shelves, but making sure that the people that are part of the process work with you to make sure that the job that is need to be implemented is well implemented. So my only comment on that is, let's get the best expert for the job and not just writing academic papers, but the experts that will work with you to make sure whatever is on paper is implemented to the letter. And that is what I think one challenge that we face. The second one is also, let's capacitate our people internally. Are we having the right people internally to work with these aspects or to gather the right information and share the right information and use that information for advocacy of policy making? There are a lot of good people out there that can train people within the ministries, within the tourism authorities to make this happen. And those are the two things that I think that we need to do to be able to progress and move forward on these issues. Thank you.
Okay. Carmen, now, if we say that building back better, what it means is that we have to build back a sector that is resilient, robust, and can be able to stand the test of time, because we've seen that sometimes some of the over-glorified part of tourism or part of our whole national economy cannot survive in these areas. How then do we look at aviation, not just bringing the people, but looking at the opportunities, the jobs that can be created, that we believe that can be very sustainable jobs? How do we marry the two?
Kojo, an aviation sector is an enabler. It's not just for tourism. If you look at the business of aviation, it's beyond just tourism and leisure. It's really complex. It's all about the cargo. It's moving people from A to B, B to C. It's a very different dynamic, different business model. So what we need to look at in terms of rebuilding tourism in Africa from an aviation standpoint is to look at tourism from all those aspects we know. And I think Kojo, all of us, we know what can be done. And we know what has not been working. And I think we know very well, and I'm glad Mohamed Helsi mentioned here, some national carriers we have are not doing any favor to us. You know, they are doing a lot of the restriction. They are still not giving opportunities for those who come and change the dynamics. And if I look in the East African community, for jumbo jet to fly to Kigali from Nairobi, that was a conversation we were having in 2014, 2015. It took time for another airline to come with a different business model to a destination which badly needed another pricing strategy, which is not the same as KQ and Rwandair. But it took time. So for me, I think we need to really be serious about what we are talking about here. As every single one of us on this platform, we really want to see this as an opportunity to reinvent how we used to do business. And then this is a call to all the leaders and our leadership and our ministers in position right now, and then to the highest level. If we really want to make a difference, this is the time to go back to the drawing board and say, if this is not working, has not worked, definitely we need to go back and say, what else can we bring on the table? Because we have learned with COVID-19, all scenarios are possible. bring them on the table. We are happy to look at what is feasible and possible. And if I borrow what Kwakye said, you look at every expert we needed for COVID-19 was brought on the table. Any name it, statistician, data analysis, physicians, and anyone who was needed was brought into the table. I think for tourism, we need to look at this and say, we are going to do proper open surgery, heart surgery. Let's just bring the best on the table and then do it for the sake of the revival of the industry.
Let me follow it up with this then. How do we then make it, because of course, we know that it's an open knowledge that when you have more access, then it becomes even cheaper and people are able to afford the travel. Okay, but if you have situation now, you can if you have situation that sometimes key national agencies like the airport company, which is, yeah, which is quite different, but the airlines, do they have the autonomy that they need to have to be able to run effectively, Carmen?
I think the airlines usually they don't have, if you look at most of the African airlines, yeah, they don't have the capacity to really run. They are still, some of them, highly subsidized by the government. But it's high time that we really push those airlines. They are new players who are willing to come into the space. Yeah. But governments are not really giving them the space. So are we going to really continue on that avenue where we are not leading to anywhere? Or are we going to really question the status quo, because things cannot continue the way they are?
No, I agree. I absolutely agree. I think you know, you touch a very important point, Carmen. And I think COVID has really almost shaken us up, because I think where we are right now, it's a situation of we're waiting for borders to open. And I'm just making a simple example in South Africa. We're waiting for borders to open. We are saying we've got domestic travel that needs to happen. And right now, the tourism industry, the travel industry that needs to be the source market, especially for the airlines, is sitting and saying, we don't know whether this is, don't know whether that is correct, and should we or shouldn't we? And here we are, we're needing a very strong body, I think in the form of Kwakye and team, to start saying, we as the tourism industry are saying, yes, this is domestic travel, this is the requirements, and this is how the requirements will happen. To sort of, it's almost like removing the noise. And I think the noise factor is the one that we started seeing now, because now it's almost like there is a lot of government interaction or interference, whereas government has given the legislation and as to what it is. The airlines and every partner has now interpreted what it is that they're supposed to do. The traveler at the end doesn't know whether I'm compliant or not compliant. And now here we are, we're sitting with airlines who can't even fly because they can't fill up seats. So we've got a different problem now. So now we're saying government can say, government has got the policy. Now we need a very decisive body to guide the entire industry. Okay. As one.
Okay. Kwakye, there's a question from Mohamed Hersey. He'll be joining us very soon, but he asked the question of, is African Union owning up and pushing the SATAM agenda passionately so that it can resonate with the whole thing that we're talking about, African aviation, single markets, connecting the continent?
Kojo, that's a very interesting point that you've raised. There are a lot going on with AU and other institutions trying to resolve the tourism problems and aviation and what have you. If you have an elephant, you cut it into pieces and then you eat bit by bit. If we look at AU, AU agenda is Agenda 2063, although some are being implemented, but at a very slow pace. There are ways that we can do this. Countries can collaborate. We've been speaking about this. East Africa is doing very well. You can get Kenya, Rwanda, Uganda, Ethiopia, whatever. We can start very small. We then need to go around and say, it got to be dictated by Africa Union. Bilateral agreements work. What my proposal would be, let's start with countries' bilateral agreement. Rwanda Air, Kenya Airways, Rwanda Tourism, Kenya Tourism, Kenya Federation, Rwanda Tourism Chamber, let them work together. Ghana Tourism, Kenya Tourism, they can work together. When we start looking at those corridors of collaboration, we will make progress. But going to the African Union is nice to have. The debate has been going on for years and years and years. Things are being done. But don't forget that each country has got its own level of development. They got their own regulatory framework. And there are so many people involved. And that makes it very difficult even for the commissioners to move. However, if we start by looking at country by country collaboration, looking at segments, and working together in smaller groups, I believe that is going to work. For instance, Ghana and Togo are our neighbors. They can work together. Rwanda, I've mentioned. South Africa works closely with a lot of its neighbors. And that needs to happen. My belief is that, so it's the same way that we have the command council for COVID, let's have the command councils across the continent for tourism. Let's get the best minds on the table and let them help the countries to get this thing working. And that will be my recommendation.
Just to add that, as a convener of the African Tourism Leadership Forum again, what are you doing from your own platform and from your own organization to be able to, at least they said, to start a process that we know that, because it won't start a day. Africa, is in 2063. But what are the things that you think you can do to be able to bring some of these things to the fore or begin a concrete conversation and implementation of some of these things in a minute? If you can help us.
There have been a couple of programs. One, last February, all the countries, I'm talking of the conference side, have agreed to work together. They've established through us what they call Coalition of Africa Convention Bureaus. And the whole idea is for them to be able to lobby together, to be able to share the spoils of what comes out of conferences. So if South Africa has held a conference and the conference cannot come here, instead of going to Europe, that particular business can go to Kenya, Rwanda, Lesotho, or wherever. So that is one thing that we are very proud of ourselves that we achieved. The second one, which was very good for us, is that all the CEOs have now formalized what we call the Africa Tourism CEOs Forum. And they held their first meeting on the 17th of June. The outcome of that meeting, we've escalated to UNWTO. Another meeting was held on the 30th of June. Now, that UNWTO, one thing that they are going to do is working on what we call One Africa campaign, which we believe that is a strong way to advocate for the industry. So those are the two things. The third one, we provided a platform for small enterprises across the continent so that they can also work together, share knowledge, and be able to support each other. So at that level, we believe that with these bodies, the advocacy role that we want to play on the continent through Africa Tourism Leadership could possibly be strengthened. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Mohamed Harris will join us very soon. But before he comes in, Amanda, now, are you guys ready? If I say you guys, i.e. the airport, the infrastructure, the airport company, sometimes you realize that you travel and Africa is not an exception, that people go to destinations and they realize that some of the services, experiences at our airports sometimes leave much to be desired. And are we able to put in the necessary infrastructure to ensure that the traveler goes through and have enjoy the experience of traveling at African airports?
Yes.
Because airport itself can generate a lot of revenue. So if you have if you don't have those facilities that we can use as propellers to be able to show revenue, then we may just be receiving a slice of the cake. And are you guys ready to be able to put yourself in the position that you make the experience seamless in terms of travel?
Yes. Look, I think in terms of Cape Town, there's been a lot of work that has been done. But not only that, I think pre-COVID, and I think before we put down in March, I think Cape Town was in the biggest form of its own transition, where we were building the airport and sort of, not only sort of, but I think we were in a massive way in which we were going to be developing, especially the international wing, because in our 3 or 4 years of growth, we've seen that the international market has been growing the most. And naturally, and it's not just Cape Town, I think just Johannesburg as well, or Tambo has also seen the same growth. So there were huge capital projects that were already started, which unfortunately, I think due to COVID had to be stopped. And you obviously have to just now sort of reset the and say, okay, so are we ready or not? There are a couple of factors, yes. I think, you know, as an international traveler, you look at our lounges, you look at the state of whatever it is that you are looking for in terms of the experience that you would get in any other airport. So you're looking at digital, and I'm just not looking at current now, I'm just saying post-COVID. We're looking at the way in which you're seeing it, you're saying the digital world is going to be very key to the traveler, the way, you know, of comfort, the way of health and safety is going to be one of those, you know, those are now the key things that a traveler, and not only just the traveler, but the airport is now going to look at. So the way in which we're going to operate is going to be very differently. So it's going to be quite interesting as to what then developments that we are then going to put in as a result of all that.
Carmen, let me, if you can give me your parting words, that how are we prepared to be able to ensure that we play our part? Because when airlines are coming through, there's a service, there's a hotel,
yes,
there's a whole supply chain, or you know, of the tourism sector. How are we prepared to be able to ensure that travelers, Africans have said, because often than not, I mean, again, I'm sorry to say that there's a certain penchant for some of the things that happen in some of our airports that I believe that if it's corrected, people are, because people fly, and if people are making transits, sometimes they choose different airports because it has peculiar or something unique. Do you think that we are able to bring ourselves to that technology level to ensure that our people are ready to build back better post-COVID?
Thank you, Kojo. I think, do we have a choice? I think if you adapt or you die, very simple.
Yeah.
You adapt or you die. Some airports and are not going to be just open and be digitized, eco-friendly or COVID-19 pandemic for health and safety measures already now in September or August. But this is going to be requiring more investments. And as Amanda mentioned, yeah, all these infrastructures have to come from somewhere. Where is the taxpayers' money? Where is it going to go? We need to pay attention to where the government is going to put money, because also the way we build the confidence, it's going to be very important. You know, some destinations are opening their airlines and airports in the month of August. I'm not keen to travel now, even though I'm a very seasoned and keen traveler. I'm just going to wait and watch, because I think some destinations are going to be leading while others are going to lag behind. And those who think business is as usual, they should pay attention. Some of us, we are now conscious about the choice of travel. If I have to do a direct flight from Kigali or Nairobi to Amsterdam, and then between now and you have to make a choice whether you do a stopover one destination, we are going to be very the very kind of like calculated risks. And then now, it's based on different factors we were not taking into consideration prior COVID-19. That, honestly, for me, health and safety was important, but I didn't realize how important it is, because now my health is important. If I'm stranded in any of the major international airports right now, what are the guarantee that if I have COVID-19, the healthcare, which hospital, which health facilities beyond the infrastructure? I think we cannot talk about just airports. It's everything about the airport. If I happen to be sick in Cape Town, most likely I'm going to get decent healthcare facilities, but do I have insurance? Now we are bringing many aspects. But if I happen to be in an interesting country in West Africa or East Africa, with, let's just take for the sake of Sudan, I'll have to think twice. I have to think twice if I get sick, if something happens. So it's not just about ready in terms of airports or aviation or
the ecosystem.
The whole ecosystem. And pay attention. I think we need to also pay attention. Is also the decision some of our governments are going to have to make, the trade-off. And that these are going to be very good trade-off. Whether you trade off for better infrastructure or you compromise on A and B and C, but who is the winner and loser? Yeah. Those are very, very difficult decisions. I will not envy anyone who sits as a Minister of Finance right now in the COVID-19. It's about Minister of Education, Minister of Health, Minister of Infrastructure, and
which one do you want to say first?
Where do you stop? So it's not just about airports. For me, airport is one small component. Now, as a traveler, I need many, many checkpoints. And those for me so far, I am still yet to see what is going to happen.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Kwakye, let me pick your final thoughts on how you think that we can build back better, robust jobs and resilient as a sector, and be prepared as people, to ensure that we come out of COVID well, good to go. It may not be perfect, but a bit of assurance that the sector is a sector that we can, we can be proud of if we put things, and not just proud of, but it can produce the things that needs, the continent needs the most to ensure that we come out of this COVID better.
Kojo, I'll talk about three.
Yes.
I mentioned collaboration. Okay.
Briefly,
There are lateral and vertical collaboration. Internally, tourism need to engage aviation, airport, and in today's world, with the health ministry. So we need, I'll put it, in countries, tourism, South Africa, we call it tourism, we call it the command council, the COVID command council. We need that command council to be working with tourism to look at how do we get more people. And that is about visa, about airport taxes, it's about incentives. So domestically, we need to do that. That needs to be escalated, even if we cannot go beyond our neighbors, with our neighboring countries, to make sure the same for collaboration. So we have to have that. The second level, the countries themselves, neighbors, and across the continent need to collaborate. I said, either bilaterally or regionally. So any country that is working. The third critical point, we know the airlines are not doing well, but we got Kenya Airways, we got Ethiopia Airways, we got Rwanda Air, and a few other airlines that are working. The African countries, and they fly to African destinations. Let's start thinking. And I urge the airline, John, I will ask you to support it. I see that the Secretary General of AFRAM is here. Let's get the airlines to basically work with us to make sure that the packages, that advocacy with the government for the airport taxes, the visa fees, are basically improved. If we can do that now, I believe that regionally we will do much better than we'll be doing. Then finally, it's about training and capacity building. Our people need to be trained. Are people being trained now? I don't think a lot is being done. People are struggling, the SMMEs, what kind of capacity? They don't have money to buy food. They don't have money to do anything. The least we could do is to support them, whether it's virtual. And that, the tourism and the ministry and regulators have the responsibility to engage the telecommunication companies. I've said it so many times, to give data to these people, to allow them to get access. And that is one critical role that will not cost anybody anything, that we can support them at no cost. So those are the things that I feel we can do to come back. Thank you.
No, thank you very much. And I know that the SMEs are they are in your hearts, and the reason you are putting in the associate program, for them. Thank you, Mr. Kwakye. Thank you, Dr. Carmen Nibigira and Amanda, for such an insightful conversation. Bring your expertise with us. I'll hand over to John, and then he can do the wrap up. Then we can go. And thank you for our audience who've been with us and listening to the conversation and sharing your insight with us. John?
Thanks, Kojo, and thanks Kwakye, Carmen, and Amanda for the great insights. As I say, all these sessions are going to be recorded. They'll be put onto YouTube. People can go back and view them whenever they want. And I think that there'll be a bit of a flag in the sand here, because a lot of the stuff that you just said right at the end there, Kwakye, I couldn't agree with you more. You know, just internet connectivity, actually, that's held back probably some people from coming today. We know that this platform requires strong Wi-Fi, and it needs, if you're paying for data, it's expensive. We don't have an alternative at the moment in terms of the way we deliver our conferences. And the whole idea of this conference was to make it free and accessible for every single person. Because normally we can't do that. I get inundated with people who say, can I come to your conference? And I say, well, I can't pay to fly you to X, Y, and Z. I can't pay for your hotel. I can't. So actually this way, I don't have to buy anybody's lunch and we're still sharing that information. What I believe is that information when it comes to our industry should be free. So that's why we have a podcast with 130 interviews available for free. We have a YouTube channel, everything is free. All of these sessions will be free because if you're going to educate, you need to provide the access, but I can't personally provide that Wi-Fi connectivity for everybody. That's the huge challenge. So thank you so much, Kojo. You did a great job as always. There was never any doubt in my mind. And you know, as I said, go over and see the Voyage Afriq guys, get in touch with Kojo, subscribe to the website and to the newsletter and the Tourism Wrap, which is a new innovation, which is fantastic.